Well, I just got off the phone with someone in the Philippines, and I said, how is 2014? Because it's already 2014 there, and they said, so far so good, and hopefully it stays good. But I can tell you this, it's not going to be a very good year. 2014, in fact, what I have seen and what has been brought to my attention in a very shocking way, actually, is that the bubble, the QE, quantitative easing bubble, which is, has eased the whole debt situation, etc., is a house of cards. I've been saying that all along. And the bubble is going to burst in 2014, probably very early in 2014, maybe sometime around the early February. The wheels are going to come off the Fed policy, and I will explain more of that to you. What happened to me over the holidays is I was in a situation, an incredible situation where it was brought to my attention the severity of what is to come in a very frightening way, and really I was very fortunate to not be harmed, actually. And I've been trying to process this. And what happens is, in certain people, they get the shock of the future ahead of time, which has always been my life. I'm get shocked by what is coming in the future, so then I can have time to smooth it out in my own psyche, own being, so that I can help to people. And what is coming in 2014, likely 2014, there's an outside chance it could be 2015, but I'm betting on 2014. But it's hard to nail down time frames. I was shown a time frame when the blossoms on the fruit trees are starting to show, which is here in California, early February. But actually, I saw the acacia tree today, which is a little yellow flowers, already blooming. Acacia tree was in strong bloom 31st of December. Incredible. It's the driest year on record in California. It's a drought. It's very warm here and just beautiful blue skies every day, but no water. Okay. It's a very drastic situation for the farmers in the Central Valley here. So I'm saying that the quantitative easing policy of the Fed is going to fail. It's created this massive bull market, which is an illusion. It's brought all the suckers in, and it is going to crash, and it's going to crash extremely hard. It's going to be a crushing fall for the overall world economy, and people are going to lose their minds. They're going to freak out, as I experienced over the holidays. I was shaking and trembling. It was such a shocking situation I was put into, and have had to gradually try and come out of it, but I'm not entirely out of it. Am I very sort of tired and weak from the situation? So I've said for a long time that eventually this is a house of cards. The economy, the world economy, based on debt, what's going on is a house of cards. It's going to come down, and it's just when is the question. Well, what happened was the Fed decided, instead of letting it come down and you know, treating the cause of it, the whole problem, the cause of it, and I'll tell you what the cause of it all is. They decided, no, they're going to artificially stimulate it. Now, you can never stimulate yourself out of a depression, actually. If you understand what depression is actually dismay over the fact that we have this severe continuity problem. And what the world does, the ego-driven world, it tries to stimulate itself out of this depression. Eventually, what happens is you go through a period of stimulation, and then depression comes back even worse. Another period of stimulation comes back even worse, and another comes back even worse. At some point, you can't go any further. And what usually happens in the world is a final stimulation is applied, which is what? Write it on the blackboard. W-A-R, war, is what happens. War is the ultimate stimulation to try and raise us out of our deep, deep despondency. We are actually extremely despondent. That is a fact. And people cover that up. They hide it with all the stimulation. The whole world seems to be based on stimulation right now, right? If you look at it that way, then things will become very plain to you. And so much stimuli. The pulsing music, you know, that came into in the 70s and late 70s and the 80s, all the pulsations and stuff. All that's designed to stimulate, all the drugs, everything that's going on in the world is to create an artificial euphoria, as it were, stimulate us, but then we start to feel this terrible inner sort of fatigue and despondency, and then more stimulation and more stimulation. Eventually, the wheels come off, and when they come off is difficult to pinpoint. I have some idea. It could in the first quarter. It could be the first fiscal quarter of 2014, and there are quite a few bears who are also saying this. Actually, but I didn't realize this. I didn't know. After I received this information and the situation came to my attention, I went on YouTube and I looked and I saw these people saying, "Wow, first quarter of 2014 is likely a huge crash." And I certainly am a big, big bear, okay? A huge bear on this whole financial edifice that we have stimulated, all right? Thinking that, oh my gosh, look at this, the stock market's gonna keep going up forever. You know, happy days are here again. It's not true, it is not true. There's just this, the bubble is so huge that people don't even see it. Remember in 2008, not a lot of people saw the bubble, okay? I had intimations of it, and I was told, you know what, no, it's gonna correct, no problem. I said, I don't think so. It's gonna get a lot worse. It got a lot worse. This one, though, that's coming is a mega crash, actually, a mega correction. What is important to understand about the world is you cannot stimulate yourself out of a depression, which is all the world really ever does, except for those people who actually listen to the wise ones who know the way out of our severe despondency is the resolution to the continuity problem. That is the way out. And those are the great sages, saints, and saviors, and gurus, and avatars, and all those who actually know the truth. And they tell us for sure, stimulating yourself out of your situation doesn't work. It leads to disaster. So, in a nutshell, the so-called cognoscenti, the leaders of the world who have been manipulating the current, the financial situation, and the social situation through all this entertainment and tinseltown, they don't know what they're doing. And that's a scary thing. People cannot accept that, which is why they keep on going with it, because they don't know where else to turn. They just assume that the leadership of the world must know what they're doing, and humans are somehow infallible. That they've been educated at university, somehow they're infallible, and somehow they have the answer. They don't have the answer. They don't know the answer. They're wrong. They're mistaken. They're drastically off track. And I can say that because I've had the good fortune to know those who do know the way. So it doesn't frighten me to say that these superstars of the world of finance and politics that are clueless as far as what the answer really is. It doesn't bother me the slightest bit because I know those who do know the answer. One of those is Ramana Maharshi, who had a birthday on December 30th. 134 years ago he was born, and this was one that actually did know the way for us to get free of this dreadful situation that we're in, actually. A situation where we believe that we can somehow crush pure spaciousness, that pure spaciousness is crushable, or that we can kill it, it's killable, or that it's catchable, we can capture it, or that we can inflict pain upon it, or that we can twist it, or that we can stretch it, or we can do anything to it, that we can evaporate it, All the stuff that we are pretending that we can do to matter is just a symbolic acting out, actually, of what we believe we can do to pure spaciousness. And the great sages tell us, we can't do anything to pure spaciousness, so give it up. Give up your search for a way to affect pure spaciousness. It's zero-dimensional, pure absence, that there's nothing there to do anything to, but it's a positive pure absence, okay? It's not like a negation of something. It is a positive pure absence. It is a perfect zero-dimensionality, which everything arises in that, okay? okay? There's nothing that arises within it that can affect it in any way. So these great sages know that. And they know that all the stimulation that we're carrying out is the wrong path. It is a path designed to keep us believing in what can never happen, believing that the impossible is possible, instead of looking at our fatigue and depression and saying, wow, you know, what's going on? What am I trying to do? And then accepting the remedy for it. Instead of that, we keep on misapplying the stimulus package in so many different ways in society. And you have all these cheerleaders out there cheering it all on constantly. In the popular media, popular entertainment, the news, this just through and through and through and through, the whole world is just saturated with this cheerleading attitude towards more and more stimulation, more and more stimulation. And those who say no to that path, they say, ah, you know, you're out of it. You're old fashioned or something. You don't want to have fun, you know, that kind of thing. Well, the wheels are going to come off. They will come off. And the only remedy, the only way we can help is actually to be in a state of tranquility ourselves. So, with that in mind, I was going to stop taping, but Ramana Maharshi somehow had some grace that got to me and said, hey, you know what, why don't you, you know, keep trying. The world needs tranquility, and if you're able to at least help out in some way, it's worth doing. So I said, well, you know, it seems like what I'm going towards is not working so great. And he said, yeah, that's the problem, is that you're making the videos too short and too colorful, too short. You know, go back to the long format. The plain long format is the way to do it. And I said, wow, okay, I kind of understand where are you coming from. Because I play a round of golf several days ago, and very rusty, haven't been out in quite some time, actually. And there was nobody behind me, and a very slow group's in front of me. The whole time, nobody behind me. So I said, what do? I can't go anywhere. I was by myself, so I decided just to practice, a practice round. So I'd hit like 5 shots every hole, 5 drives, 5 approach shots, 5 putts, chipping, and just practice. And as I did that, toward the end of the round, I began to figure stuff out in a tremendous fashion. And I just said, wow, I really get it. You know, I'm really, things are really clicking. I started to play, you know, very, very well. And I got the impression that this is like a template for how video should be. It should be a practice round. Not on the driving range, let me tell you. What you do on a driving range does not translate onto a golf course at all. The same thing is what we do, just kind of like mouthing spiritual platitudes, you know. It's not good enough. It doesn't translate into the real difficulty that we need to overcome. So a video should be like a round of golf, a practice round of golf. And that is, you go over and over and over stuff. And you don't care if you miss your shot. I hit a bad drive, and goodbye, you know, it's in the bushes, okay, tee up another one. That one's also short, to the right, tee up another one. That's long, but it's up by the bushes too, and lost that one. Tee up a third, you know, another one, fourth one. So that's a little bit left, and then I finally said, let me adjust, try to figure this out. Teed up a fifth ball and hit it just beautifully right down, really long and beautiful. I said, okay, I learned something there, made a little progress. So that's really the way the spiritual path is you have to keep trying, and you're probably going to fail most of the time, all right? Honestly, it's super difficult to understand anything that's said that of any consequence. It's very difficult. And if you can just get it for a moment, just say, okay, I sort of get that. You know, that's like a drive right down the middle. You say, the other ones weren't so good. Maybe you lost your ball. But if you can just sort of say, I sort of feel like there's something there, and it's, you know, yeah, I feel comfortable with it, I feel aligned with that. That is very good progress, actually. Very, very great progress. I've seen Ramana Maharshi, you know, most of my life. I've been aware of him, and most of the time I just didn't get a I didn't have a clue what he was talking about or what he stood for or anything. It was just too difficult. And gradually, I'm gradually seeing it. You know, he's just abiding in that knowing of pure spaciousness. That's all. That's all he's doing. Very simple. But we somehow have all these opinions of what he's doing, and none of the opinions are correct. In fact, this whole world is nothing but opinions about spaciousness, about what we can do to spaciousness, about what can happen to spaciousness. And what all Ramana was saying is that nothing can happen to spaciousness. So stop your, don't worry, you know, give up your concern and worry and effort and all that. Nothing can happen to it. And so there's no more concern, right? He's not concerned about what we're doing. Can you light a fire to pure spaciousness? Can you be incendiary to it? Can you boom, you know? Can you hit it with a hammer? Can you cut it with a saw? Can you build something around it? Can you put it in a cage? Start thinking along those lines, and it may seem strange, but again, just one little click. I was at a par three, and I hit the ball, thought really well, and I went up to the green. I hit one ball. I said, "Wow, that's a beautiful shot." I get up there, it's short. It's in a terrible situation by a sand trap, and I'm just like, "Wow!" I said, "What happened? That's crazy." I said, "You know what? I'm gonna drive back to the tee. There's nobody behind me, and I'm gonna work this out." So I thought I had it, and I didn't. You see, that is what happens on the spiritual path. You think you got it, and then you realize, no, I don't really have it. You got to go back and say, let me try again. So I started trying and trying and said, ah, oh, that one's a little short. And I figured something out, the angle of the approach, you know, how steep the angle of approach is. I flattened it out. I flattened the angle of approach out. And then I hit the ball just beautifully right distance. One ball was like 6 inches from the hole, almost had a hole in one. Just a little adjustment, figuring it out, and suddenly, like, problem solved. Okay, same thing with the spiritual path is you just keep your poise, and you're not getting it, but you just keep trying, and then suddenly at some point you may notice, like, ah, okay, it's like this, and then yeah, it's like this, and then ah, see, I got it. That's what it's like. So it's, you see, how long do you spend around a golf? 4.5 hours. I mean, this tape, I don't know how long it'll be. I guess I can make it as, no, I can only make it like 2 hours because I have to add these videos together. So 2 hours is the longest I can make it, unfortunately. If I did it, I don't know how long I could make it. As far as another way of taping, on Ustream it's 3 hours is the longest. And taping direct to YouTube, I don't know how long it can be. As far as uploading a video, it can be even longer, 5 hours if I upload one, or however long, 8 hours, I don't know. But the idea is it should be a chunk of time where you're just working on the stuff that is difficult. You think, I should be able to hit a drive in the fairway, come on. Yeah, it's no big deal. And yet, whoops, I pulled it. Whoops, it's in the bushes right. Whoops, you know, it's not a good one, not a good one. And you say, wow, what's going on? Well, the course psychs you out. You know, very difficult courses psych you out. You look down there, and it's just, all you see is just undulations and bushes and out of bounds and sand traps and elevation shifts and changes, and just like, wow, it just makes you think too much. So you have to have like a go-to move, something that just immediately blocks out everything else. It doesn't matter. I know exactly what I'm doing here with the swing. I'm going to look at the angle of approach here. I've got everything lined up with the grip, everything's right. So that all, everything out there, I'm not even paying attention to it. And then you just keep your head down, you know, worried about where the ball goes. You just put the right swing on it. And then you realize it's right down the middle. That's how it goes. So spiritual path is very, very similar. Is we get psyched out, very much psyched out by the world. This world is the greatest psych out there is. Psychs almost everybody out. Freaks us out. Freaks me out. Has freaked me out my whole life. And I almost get it. And then, you know, there's something else that freaks you. Freak out. It's like, whoa. And you go, somehow you lose track of it, and you can seem to lose track. get up to a really crazy difficult hole, and you forget your swing. You say, wait a minute, how am I gripping this? You know, just all these thoughts start going in your mind, and you can't just do what's simple and easy. Simple and easy. So one of the things I suggest is to say, keep it simple. I use that all the time now. Keep it simple. Keep it easy. Whenever your attention starts to wander and you get distracted, you say, now keep it simple. Keep it simple. Boom. Keep it simple. And immediately, the attention is off of that. It's just off of that. Whatever it is. If you know, you feel your attention getting pulled, just keep it. Say, keep it. I got to keep it simple right now. I'm a very, very difficult situation. And speaking of very difficult situations, you may or may not be aware of the Formula One driver Michael Schumacher, who has been called the greatest adventurer in the world, one of the most famous people in the world, most famous athletes, one of the richest athletes in the world, and somebody who seems to have been completely indomitable, one of the most fearless, you know, on the edge of recklessness drivers ever, and the guy seemed to be superhuman, actually. Really, I actually watched a lot of his races back in when he was winning Formula One championships on television, because I was fascinated by this guy who was just so fearless and seemed to be able to handle everything so beautifully. Well, he's skiing in the Alps, and just a super super freak accident happened where he somehow got caught on went over a rock, and it flipped him up, catapulted him in the air, and he came down right on his head on a rock. Split his helmet open to get brain damage, and now he's in an induced coma, in very, very serious, critical condition. I just, like, you know, could hardly believe Michael Schumacher. You know, who would believe it? This guy seemed to be invincible, one of the most invincible humans I think I've ever seen. And to be tripped up by something like that is just, you know, it makes everybody just stop and say, "Whoa, wait a minute." Well, just wait a minute. Now, I was in a situation on the road driving during this holiday season where the perfect trap happened. It was not my fault at all. And in retrospect, I probably saved quite a few lives by what I did. But in so doing, it really caused a shock to my system, because it seems like the world doesn't care at all about anyone. You know, you're you can be gone in the blink of an eye. Not only you, but other people that are with you. And, you know, it's kind of upsetting. I was pretty mad. I said, wow, world, you know, you don't want to do me, and I have some valuable information for the world, absolutely valuable. And yet the trap was so insidious, that never saw it coming. Nobody saw it coming. But the good news is that because I was driving so cautiously, carefully, and had an intuition about a dangerous situation, I said, you know, this something about this is dangerous. I'm going to be cautious. I'm going to slow down. I'm going to assess things. The cars behind me also were blocked, and they couldn't go anywhere. And then at the last second, I say, well, you know, all this pressure is on me to go, so maybe I better go. And just as I started to go, that's when the trap closed. I was able to break out of it, slam on the brakes and break out of it. If I had been an aggressive person, which in the Silicon Valley, the people here are so aggressive, is just unbelievable, really. They're frantic, they're manic, because there's so much money here, and they're desperate to get a hold of it. Desperate. And so they will not allow themselves to miss an exit, one way or the other. If they're going on a wrong exit, they will swerve back on the freeway. If they're missing their exit, they will swerve onto the exit, even though that they may be risking their lives in doing so. Because I've seen so many instances where they barely made it by like a foot, you know, at 75 miles an hour. And recently, on the way to the last time I played golf, there was a terrible accident by someone hitting a barrier at an exit. So somebody missed. You see, they don't want to take, you know, 5 minutes or 3 minutes to go up the next exit and make a U-turn and you know, come back. They refuse to do it. It's unbelievable. The level of aggression on the roads here is just incredible. People are just frantic, okay? So gridlock here. It is just called the shark tank, really. And that gets into you. People don't want to let you in. You know, the courtesy is starting, consideration is starting to disappear. People are cheating on the carpool lane and in every way they can possibly cheat. They don't care. They're going to pay a ticket. They're going 85 miles an hour. The maneuvers, the reckless driving here is just off the charts. I mean, I drive around every day. I'm driving constantly. And I see stuff all the time. I just say, whoa, that is way too dangerous what's happening. And, you know, they're young, they're rich, and they're chasing, you know, multi-millionaire status. You know, everybody is here thinking that this is the land of dreams, this is the land of opportunity, I've got to seize it now. And they can't even wait for a minute. They don't have consideration, it is lacking here. So, fortunately, I still have that, and I said, you know what, I'm going to go slow here. I'm going to go slow. If I was an aggressive driver with the mindset of the Silicon Valley, I would have passed this truck with a huge oversized load. I would have gone right past it. I would have said, what the heck, you know, I'm going for it. The problem is that the cars behind me would likely have followed, and they would have been trapped when the whole road suddenly narrowed severely down. The massive truck with this huge wide load just had to swerve into the left lane, and there was no space for another car. Would have crushed whatever's there, would have crushed it, absolutely crushed it. And the cars behind me would have been crushed. So by going slow, being cautious, not being aggressive, even though I was late, I said, well, I'm gonna just take it easy here. I'm just gonna take it easy. They were forced to wait behind me. They were forced to, whether they liked it or not. And that probably saved a number of lives, actually. So out of that, I realized that going slow, going cautious, being non-aggressive, going towards tranquility, not being in a hurry, you know, to grab some sort of material wealth, this whole attitude is super important. It's going to save lives here. And so those who watch this video, it's incumbent upon you to accept your role in also having this attitude of a non-manic attitude, okay, a tranquil attitude. And these longer videos bring this out in you. They bring it out. You begin to focus in and slow down. If we don't do this, the world is going to get to us. I guarantee you that in 2014, probably early on, the world is going to become very manic, very manic. And I can tell you why. The whole effort to stimulate ourselves out of despondency and depression, which the world is a very despondent place, actually. It's an inherently despondent place, because what we're trying to do here doesn't work. It never will work. It never has and never will work. And we get frustrated, we get despondent, we feel there's something drastically wrong. And so we keep stimulating ourselves to keep trying more, harder and harder, more and more and more and more. Eventually, that builds up a mood of aggression. A mood of aggression. And we don't even realize how aggressive we become. I think these people in the Silicon Valley don't realize how extremely aggressive they have become. People, men and women, the women are just aggressive, if not more so than the men. Okay, they're very aggressive here. And they'll cut you off, and you know, this, you know, the whole attitude is, get out of my way, me first, me first, me first. And so everybody's aggressive here. And that leads into severe problems eventually. It's a domino effect. The more aggressive you are, the more things you see are getting in your way. You know, how is it that when you're desperate to get somewhere on time, that's when all the obstacles arise? Ah, that light, you know, the traffic light. That person cut me off. They slowed me down. I missed the traffic light. Everything seems to go wrong when you're aggressively trying to push something. Whereas if you're mellow, you're tranquil, you're relaxed, and you say, you know what, I'm going to be considerate, I'm going to be patient, and in a great mood, it seems like stuff opens up for you and things go okay, you know? Nothing ruffles your feathers. It's a weird thing. But the more aggressive you get, the more angry you get at how you feel stuff is trying to hold you back and get in your way. And it keeps snowballing, 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 until you end up culturally and planetarily, you end up in war. You end up in, I mean, this world has ended up in drastic wars throughout its entire history. Who are we to believe that all has suddenly vanished and never is going to happen again? Exactly why, you know, Oh, we're into the photon bell. Okay, so this is never going to happen again. Really? How did it happen before? You see, look at it. Well, aggression built up in people. People began to accept a highly aggressive lifestyle as normal and stop paying attention to tranquility, which brings us back to Ramana Maharshi, who was the ultimate, one of the ultimates in tranquility. One of the ultimates, okay? Super valuable presence in the world. Very rarely do we get anyone come into this world like that, especially in the modern age. Super tranquil. Not comatose, super tranquil, but very clear. You know, very clear and aware, but just totally tranquil. And he says, I'm just abiding in my true, the true nature, our true nature, which is pure spaciousness, actually. Abiding in the self, we call it the self. And that's inherently tranquil, without having to do any, without having to think about it at all. It's inherently tranquil, without any need for thought to make it so. So we have this great example of tranquility. And of course, Ramana is very famous among certain class of people who are tuned into that. And he's had an immeasurable effect on the world as far as spiritual aspiration goes for those who are oriented that way. He's really had this enormous effect. And yet, most people don't even know about him. And if they see him, they just shrug it off, like, who's this guy, you know, what is this nonsense, you know? You know, where's the aggression? I don't see the aggression. I want to find Superman, you know. I want to see Michael Schumacher, who was the ultimate, you know, in aggression, an aggressive competitiveness, really, hyper aggressive and competitive. And then he has this, at the age of 44, this terrible accident where he wasn't really even going that fast and just, you know, just a freak accident that, you know, just drastically terrible. So, for those of you bulls who think the stock market is going to go up forever because the world is in such an aggressive mood and the Fed was so super aggressive, the Fed's been super aggressive, okay, you've got a severe situation coming up where it's going to flip on its head. It's going to flip on its head, okay? That Schumacher thing is a warning. It's a warning. So someone who was the most daring, aggressive, successful, you know, athlete maybe you've ever seen, maybe the greatest driver in history, suddenly flips up on his head and has massive, you know, brain trauma and is in an induced coma and in bad shape. So that, when we're talking about he's in bad shape, he's in real bad shape. That's what the economy is going to be. And the economy is going to be in really a coma, a severe coma, and people are going to be losing it. And I just went through this whole feeling of shock, you know, and feeling all the trembling and shaking inside and feeling like you're losing your equilibrium. You're going to go into a severe depression. That's what I felt like. And somehow I'm battling out of it bit by bit. But it was touch and go. It was very difficult. I know that what's going to happen is people are going to start medicating themselves. There's no question about it. When you're in a situation like I was feeling, if you were, you know, used to taking medications, you're going to start medicating yourself because you're going to feel like the wheels are coming off. The wheels are coming, and you don't feel like you're able to do anything about it. And I saw this Ramana Maharshi's 30th, I mean, his birthday, and I saw that and I said, wow. That's incredible. You know, I almost missed it, but I didn't. You know, this is very significant. And that kind of, like, helped save me, you know? I just said, someone was really here. I mean, it's his birthday, folks. You know, he was here in 1879 on December 30th. This ocean of tranquility was born into the world. And I met him in his subtle spiritual body in a dream once. And he was just the coolest, kindest, compassionate, down, you know, unselfconscious, down to earth, so to speak, person you could ever hope to meet. You know, just like so friendly, with no attitude like he's superior to you or anything like that. And just speaks to you just, you know, totally kindly and peacefully and intelligently. And you just say, wow, I never even knew anyone like that even existed, actually. That kind of persona could even exist. So he is still in a subtle spiritual body here, in my opinion. He's still blessing the world. He's still helping us, absolutely, as are a lot of spiritual teachers, like Longchenpa is another one, like Ramana Maharshi. The same tremendous, clear bliss and very compassionate and very intent on helping us here. Very intent, very intense as far as commitment to helping us. So there are quite a few saints around, quote unquote, the throne of God's pure spaciousness who want to help us, but we seem to be quite resistant to this help, which is very unfortunate. And yet, it's not easy. Just like a game of golf is not easy. You think it should be easy, but it's not. This is very similar to golf. You say, wow, I should ease, that's no problem. I should be able to hit it there. What's the big deal? And then you can't. You say, what? The spiritual path is like that. You think, oh, this is easy. Okay, I get it. And yet, you don't quite get it. And then the next day, it's harder. And one day, I sort of get it. Next day, I sort of don't get it. We oscillate. We fluctuate like that. We don't understand that we cannot fluctuate pure spaciousness. We cannot oscillate it. We cannot slice it. We cannot dice it. We cannot fragment it. We cannot, fragment it at all. We cannot do any of that stuff. We cannot fragment it. We cannot encircle it. We cannot outdistance it. We cannot shrink it. We cannot freeze it. We cannot boil it. Okay, there's nothing we can do with physics about it whatsoever, or biochemistry. We can't slice its genetic code of pure spaciousness. It doesn't have a genetic code. All right? We can't split the atoms. It doesn't have any atoms. All right? You hear that? Pure spaciousness does not have any atoms. We can't take a sledgehammer to it. Right? We cannot. We cannot even build upon it. Can't do any of that. And yet we're so conditioned of these opinions that we can, that we keep oscillating and saying, okay, I did this, I got it now, but what about this? Oscillate, pulsate. All this pulsating electronic music is a big problem, actually. Because what we need to realize is this, is that which cannot, which is free of all pulsation, all vacillation, all alternation, totally smooth, sameness, seamless smoothness, sameness, pure zero-dimensional spaciousness. Beyond any thought or idea of it. Okay, we can't pin it, we can't pin it somewhere. We can't place it somewhere. We cannot place it. We cannot define it. It's beyond opinion. It's beyond definition. It's beyond thought, beyond idea, beyond conception, beyond all of that. It is prior. It is zero dimensionality. So, we have these opinions about it. And we're so addicted to all this stuff that we can't help but keep thinking, okay, let me do this now. And then relativistic, we say, okay, I did this, and then relative that, I did this, and how does this affect this? Not understanding that neither one nor the relationship between these two has any effect on it whatsoever. So we waste our time in all this relativistic considerations about, it's real hot here, and it's cold here, and we're thinking about all this dualistic stuff, not realizing that pure spaciousness cannot get hot, and it cannot get cold, and it cannot be anywhere in between hot and cold either. It doesn't have any qualities to it, except quality freeness, which is a positive quality freeness. I call it the isn't-ness of it. And so what we need to accept, that it is the isness of it, of its isn'tness, actually. The isness of it, of its isn'tness. That's why the great teachers say it both is and it isn't. Okay, it both is and it isn't. Because there is the isn'tness of it. Okay? This is a beautiful way to experience what it's like to get past duality, is to say the is isness of the isn'tness of it. There is the isn'tness of isn'tness. There is isn'tness. There is isn'tness. That's like hitting a golf shot over and over, okay? I missed that one. Let me try that. There is isn'tness. Let me adjust a little bit. There is isn'tness. Abide in the non-abidance. Abide in the non-abidance of pure spaciousness. There's not even an abidance in pure spaciousness, so abide in that non-abidance. Experience the isness of the isn'tness of it. Abide in the zero dimensionality of it. You think, how can I abide in zero dimensionality? Well, what is zero dimensionality, really? Is it a dimension? No, it's not really even a dimension. It's everywhereness. You see, without a second, everywhereness without a second, how do we even, you know, it's kind of like there an isn'tness to it, right? Because whatever we try to say about it, it isn't that. No matter what quality, whatever we do, it isn't that. So there's this pure isn'tness of it. So abide in the pure isn'tness. And yet we can abide in it because it isn't. And don't forget to laugh at this world. This world is absolutely laughable. It's so absurd. That's actually how I began to recover from the shock of this trauma that I experienced. I started to laugh at the situation. You know, I said, you know, it's obviously showing me something what's going to happen in the world. And I was able to laugh and it loosened me up. And when you're really in shock, remember to laugh. Remember to laugh a little bit at the absurdity of this world, at how completely cuckoo it is, and how terrible it's going to be. And it's really, oh, it's so bad as humorous, this world. So bad as humorous. A lot of terrible news around I'm aware of in my immediate life, etc. I'm fine, but there's a lot of, you know, drastic stuff taking place in other people. And just like one thing after the other. Have to keep your sense of humor. And really have to be able to laugh at the world and chuckle at it and say, you know, all this stuff we're trying to do to spaciousness, everything that happens here is something we're trying to do to pure spaciousness. We're trying to do that too. We're trying to get pure spaciousness to die. So that's why we die. We're trying to get it to die. We think by through our death, it's going to die. That we did something to it. Yeah, we accomplished something. No, we didn't. Never accomplished anything. How can we accomplish anything? How can we get a hold of pure spaciousness? Can we grab it? No, even the grabbing is abiding in the zero dimensionality. Just decorations. But nothing is actually happening to pure spaciousness. No matter what we do. So this whole world is actually just complete folly. Absolute folly. No need for it whatsoever. Never has been any need for it. Much ado about nothing, as Shakespeare said. Much ado about nothing. Nothing is happening here. The happening is only relative to other happening. But there's no absolute happening here whatsoever. None. So nothing is real here, as it really. Nothing is real. Now, I went to a New Year's Eve party, but in the late afternoon, as a courtesy thing, and then left early and came back home doing this taping on New Year's Eve. Whereas at the party, everybody's getting all stimulated by, you know, whatever, the whole party scene type of thing. And woohoo, you know, it's New Year's, oh, that's good. And all the fireworks displays that you see around the world, I haven't seen any of them, haven't paid any attention to anything. That's all designed to stimulate you. Like, you know, start the year. What you do is you try to commit yourself to even more stimulating 2014 by kaboom, 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 boom, 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 all these fireworks. And that's how you get on track with that. And that's a huge mistake. It's a huge mistake to do that. You need to get on track with tranquility. Get on track with tranquility. This is going to be a tranquil year. We're going to be like Ramana Maharshi. We should be. We should be. There's no reason why we can't. All he's doing is simply, you know, abiding in pure spaciousness, and understanding that all thoughts don't affect it at all, so he's not identifying with thoughts. Like, this is my thought. This is an important thought. You know, do we identify with non-important thoughts? We think, no, we let them go, right? They said, oh, that's not an important thought, so we drop it. We hold on to the ones we think are important. We think, well, that's my thought. That's what I'm thinking. Why we say that? Because we think it's an important thought. Some of the sages have said that none of the thoughts are actually our own. That somehow thoughts arise on their own. How that is, I'm not sure. But I have to go with that in some way. In that we do drop non-important thoughts as if saying, oh, I'm not going to think that thought. I'm not going to hold on to that thought. So thoughts are some kind of things, aren't they, that we hold on to. And so, but important thoughts, we say, hey, that's an important thought. I'm going to hold on to that thought. But what the great sages are telling us is, you don't need to hold on to any thoughts in order to abide in pure spaciousness, the everywareness of zero dimensionality, the everywareness where you're not falling anywhere. How can you fall in everywareness? Everywareness, how can you be falling? You're there, you're abiding. It's completely there for you. It is completely there for you without any need of any thought whatsoever. So, there can be thoughts there that can be used for conversation, all that stuff, but there's no identification with any of the thoughts. Like, well, this is important, so this is my thought because it's important. We fight over thoughts, like, whose thought is it? You know, that's my thought. You know, here's some of these psychics saying that, you know, they predict they some situation arises, and they say, I'm the only one. Excuse me for a second. I had to sneeze there. They say, I'm the only one. This is my thought, you know, and they claim it like as their own or something. It's ridiculous. Who wants to claim any thoughts for their own? No, it's just a thought that I'm seeing might be helpful, so I'm sharing this thought. It's not my thought. It's not anybody's thought. Thoughts are just abiding in pure spaciousness too, as are we. How important are they to that reality? They're not important at all. They have no importance. Zero importance. Thoughts have no importance whatsoever. They don't affect spaciousness at all. They do not affect. So, just like we have all these trivial thoughts come to us, we just kind of ignore. I'm just going to ignore all those thoughts. They're trivial. That doesn't interest me. And we hold on to the important ones. We can also just look at all thoughts as actually equally trivial. Equally trivial in relationship to pure spaciousness. They're equally trivial. So we don't have to identify with any thoughts. We can still have them, and we can use them, like a car or something we drive. We're not saying those are my thoughts, and you can't have those thoughts or whatever. Anybody can have any thoughts they want to. You see, when you go into the abidance, like Ramana Maharshi was, he wasn't worried about who has what thoughts. You let go of worrying about that. Say, oh, somebody else might get my thoughts. Yeah, someone else, that's what we worry about. Someone else might get my thoughts. Maybe they'll get a miracle, you know, from those thoughts, or they'll be special, you know. Someone else is going to get special. Doesn't matter, right? Because no thoughts are important. As far as abidance goes, it makes no difference one way or the other. No such thing as specialness. How can anything be specially in pure spaciousness and something unspecially in pure spaciousness? How's that? Is that possible? In everywhereness, something is specially there, something special there. How is that possible? It's not possible. Nothing is specially there. Everything is equally there. We need take no thought to be there. Jesus said, you know, look at the lilies in the field, take no thought for tomorrow. You know, in other words, you don't need to take thought to be in the everlasting arms of God, pure spaciousness. You do not. So, doesn't matter. You're not concerned who has what thoughts, that someone might have some special thoughts that you could get for yourself also and be special. You're not concerned about that anymore. So that's why you look at Ramana and you think, and he looks like he's not thinking any thoughts. He's not holding on to any thoughts. That's the expression. It's like, wow, it's a very different expression, isn't it? What is it? It's that. It's the abidance in pure spaciousness, and they're not holding on to any thoughts. They're seeing a completely blessed world, which is how the perception, the ultimate opinion of pure spaciousness, in terms of perception, in terms of an opinion, is that everything is equally blessed. There's nothing special. Nothing special. It's a vision of non-specialness, actually. But paradoxically, everything appears to be sacred. We don't see the sacredness because we're looking for specialness. We think that something is more in pure spaciousness than something else, which then invalidates the sacredness of everything else. There's no way you can see the sacredness when you insist on seeing specialness, which is why Jesus said the special relationship is one of the greatest hindrances to the vision of Christ, vision of blessed world. Is as long as you're seeing anything as special, you will automatically see other stuff as less special, which means it's not equal. You cannot see the seamless smoothness of sameness, sameness, sameness. You cannot realize the vision of blessedness and spaciousness. You cannot. It's impossible. Because you brought duality into it. That something can be more in everywhereness and something less in everywhereness. Therefore, you cannot accept everywhereness as it is. It's playing favorites somehow. It's playing favorites. So you will not see it. You will not experience it. So the non-exclusiveness of Ramana Maharshi, you're looking at it and you say, wow, he's non-exclusive. He doesn't have a look of specialness, like trying to determine what's special. he's just resting in non-specialness, you know, he's just not making any efforts. And we think, wow, what's going on here? Do I want to do that? No, I want to look like I'm making effort to, you know, find the answer, find specialness. So, what happens is the ego says we're going crazy when we let go of thoughts, you know, special thoughts, important thoughts. None of all these thoughts are equally unimportant, really. The ego says we've gone crazy, we've gone mad, we've lost our mind. Because the ego thinks our mind is a collection of special, important thoughts that we've collected. And when we let go of that, the ego says, oh, you lost your mind. So some people will say, Ramana looks like he's lost his mind or something. No, he's just realized that thoughts are not special or important. That's all. I mean, when I had the experience with him, he spoke to me completely clearly and coherently and directly. And the conversation wasn't the slightest problem in the conversation or communication whatsoever, not the slightest problem. Right? So, of course, you can still use words and concepts and thoughts, etc., but totally unattached to them. No sense of specialness whatsoever. That's a great, great state to be in. Let me tell you, he was a lot happier than any of us are, that is for sure. Very blissful. Just great serenity and bliss, or just, you know, positive bliss, like. But not in some sort of shamanistic, ecstatic state or anything like that. No, not at all. Totally tranquil, also. Very tranquil bliss. But still capable of walking, talking, and, you know, no trouble whatsoever. Again, so we loosen our mind. We don't lose our mind. But we give up the notion that we need some sort of special mind in order to, for abidance in pure spaciousness. We don't need a special mind. We don't need a mind full of special thoughts for that. And this is the great realization of these sages. And yet they say we can do it too. Absolutely. They say, of course you can. It's very simple. And in fact, everybody will have to do this eventually. All we're doing with all this stimulus programs is delay. We're just delaying the inevitable. Why delay the inevitable if the inevitable is super wonderful? It's just stupid. But there are many in the world who feel that the answer, salvation, is to never accept reality as it is, to simply believe that we have changed it. And now we're living in some different reality. And they believe that they can do that. All they're doing is delaying. Okay. But they think they have the answer. It's just continue stimulus. Let's just believe that we are in a different reality and the truth of reality doesn't apply anymore and we'll just stay here. So there's no continuity problem because we're staying here. It's like, like you've gone on a long vacation and you're staying in a cottage, some renting a cottage, leasing it, you've been there a long, long time, and then you decide you need to go back home, and you say, whoa, wait a minute, I can't remember what home was like. I'm kind of afraid of going home, and I might not know what it's like, and I'm afraid of the trip, and I just, you feel like, well, maybe I just will stay in the cottage and just make this my home. Yeah, that's the continuity problem. And people have a severe, severe problem. Everybody has the same problem. That is my go-to centering. Just like get on a hole, I need to drive the golf ball. And I say, like, all these thoughts, I say, wait a minute, what's my go-to move here? What's something I can rely on in the greatest confusion and stress? Let me just, I know it's going to work almost all the time. Let me just stick with that. Don't try to adapt to the weirdness of the hole. Just do what you know is going to work. So what really works on the path is to say, everybody has the exact same problem. We only have one problem, and everybody has that problem, the continuity problem. Continuity problem. Everybody has the same problem. Everybody has exactly the same problem. So then what that does is it centers you, so you're not thinking about solving all these other problems that actually are simply derivatives of the continuity problem. All problems are derivatives of it, every single last one. Because if not for the continuity problem, we would immediately realize that we never left pure spaciousness, and we never can, and we can never do anything to it, and poof, we'd have no more interest in trying to prove that we can do something to it. No more interest in it. We'd drop it. There's no importance to it. So the whole world, would sort of, you know, vanish, really. Like clouds just vanishing. We wouldn't keep doing it. So, no problems, you know? We'd realize that. So we have a continuity problem, and we keep continue with this continuity problem, and many people here are denying it. They say, no. I don't have a problem, continuity problem. I can go home whenever I want to, or whatever they say. And then when they try, they get all freaked out, and then they say, well, this is home, I'm gonna stay right here, or whatever, you know. When you realize you have a continuity problem, then you realize everybody has the same problem. Just very few will admit it. Very few will admit it. It's called repentance, to admit that you have a problem and that it needs to be resolved. So the first step towards tranquility is to admit I have a problem. I have a continuity problem. And then this is the mood of repentance that arises, saying, okay, this problem needs to be solved. So I'm only focused on how to solve this problem. Everything else, forget it. Not important. It's not important. So this de-emphasizes all your other thoughts. So a huge mass of thoughts are unimportant to you now, really unimportant. A few thoughts remain as important. And ultimately, you'll see that those two are not necessary or important. But what you do is you use some few thoughts in order to get rid of all the others. It's kind of like you got a huge library and you got too many books. You find a couple key books and you'd say, you know, all those other books, I don't even need them. Don't need them anymore, and you get rid of them. And then eventually, you don't need those few books either. But temporarily, it's very helpful to do it that way. So sometimes a teacher is helpful, because then you feel like you don't need any other teachers. And then eventually you realize you don't even need that teacher either. You know, you've always abided in pure spaciousness. You don't need to get back there. You never left. You just need to have this continuity problem resolved by first seeing an opinion of the fact you never left. I have this perception that I never left. I have an opinion I never left, but I don't know that I never left. But I do have this clear, seamless opinion that I never left pure spaciousness. And that's the abidance that we're looking for. That's the intermediate step that we have to take from a pragmatic standpoint. So we go over and over and over this stuff. And, you know, when you play a practice round of golf, you don't have to worry about your score. I didn't worry about my score. You lose a few balls, I don't care. It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter if you hit some bad shots. You know, you're just working on your game under the right circumstances. So it doesn't matter if you don't get some of this. It only matters that you kind of maybe get some of it and ponder on some of it. And what happens is you start recognizing that a lot of your thoughts are not important. Let me focus in on this here. And so it starts simplifying your situation. Because when you don't entertain a whole bunch of thoughts anymore, it makes it a lot easier. Just like I say, keep it simple, keep it easy. As soon as your thoughts start turning to the world, that person, this situation, you say, whoa, keep it simple, keep it easy. I have a continuity problem. If I don't solve that, I'm going to put myself through hell for sure. So he said, let me just go back to this continuity problem and how to resolve it. Those are important thoughts right now. The other stuff is not important. Not important. So that's the secret, is a lot of thoughts you used to think are important, you no longer think they're important. You just dismiss them quickly. Quickly. Keep it simple. I just say that. Keep it simple. Keep it simple. And that's the simple technique that is incredible. Just keep it simple. Start to worry about this. Needle east our mind. No. Keep it simple. Keep it simple. Don't attack what you're thinking about. Just say, no, I need to keep it simple because I got this huge continuity problem. And I know it can be resolved. I have to resolve it. And if I don't resolve it pretty soon, I'm actually going to get caught up in the mania of the world. The world is manic-depressive, actually. That's the nature of this world, is manic-depressive. It really is. And so the depression is what brings about the mania, as a means to try and cure the depression. But if you just say, well, wait a minute, I have a severe continuity problem, and I'm sort of hearing how it's solved, then you don't really get depressed. Okay. Depression is a cycle that builds up through alternating depression and mania, despondency, mania. It builds up like that, and gets worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. And I speak from direct experience in this. I really, unfortunately, know what I'm talking about here. So the way out of that is to say, you know what, I do have a severe problem, but it's not depression. It's a continuity problem. You redefine your problem, and you realize depression isn't your real problem. And very funny enough, that cures your depression. Because you no longer realize all those thoughts that I was, about depression and this, they're not important. Because that's not my problem. It's not my problem. I don't have a problem. And it works. It can work miracles. It's like a miracle cure. It works miracles for it. You still have a problem, but it's no longer depression. And it's no longer, and you don't have this mania cycle of depression and mania. And you don't get suicidal. Not so easily. You can feel like, if I don't pull out of this, I'm going to feel really suicidal. But then you just say, wait a minute, I've got one problem. It's a continuity problem. That's the only problem that I have, and there is a way to solve it. I need to get back and keep it simple, keep it easy here. Keep it simple, keep it easy. Keep it simple. I don't have time for those thoughts. They're not important. And you can literally push thoughts away. I mean, I know that sounds ridiculous, and I always thought it was ridiculous, but you don't. The way to do it is to just say, well, I got to keep it simple. And somehow that automatically pushes them away. I've never been able to, like, have a thought and then say, thought, here, I'm pushing you away. That just seems to strengthen the thought. What you just do is just say, you know what? I don't have time for your thoughts. I need to keep it simple and easy. So I'm going to do that. And somehow the thoughts kind of, like, vanish. You don't want to, like, grab a hold of a thought and say, yell, thought, I want you to go away. Then that keeps it with you. So don't address any specific thoughts. Just you're aware of them. Just say, whoa, I don't want to go there. Like, got to keep it simple. Continuity problems, the only problem I have. Keep it simple. And before you know it, you're not being bothered by a thought. And don't try to identify particular thoughts. Like, this thought is bothering me or that thought is bothering me. No. Keep it very diffuse. Say, I don't care. I don't care what thought is there. Really, it doesn't matter to me what thought is there. I have to keep it simple here because I really got a tremendous problem. It's not depression. It's an even bigger problem. But paradoxically, when you accept that you got an even bigger problem than depression, that's when you stop being depressed, and that's when your mind says, whoa, I gotta keep it simple. I've got to keep it simple here. And then you don't really experience depression anymore. You don't have time for it. You see, I got no time for depression. I gotta deal with this problem. This is a real problem. I mean, this is the problem I have. Depression happens when you deny that you have a continuity problem, and then you start feeling despondent, like what do I do then? You know, how do I get well? And then mania comes in to try and lift you out of the depression, and then you get even more depressed, and then more mania, more stimulation, and this awful vicious cycle, this death spiral that you get into in this world. And I can tell you that the world is so hooked on that, is so hooked so badly. That the world is going to go into a very severe manic episode. When you might say this bull market is a manic episode, it might be going to a very depressed episode, you know. A mixture of the two, oscillation of the two, perhaps, you know, pulsation of the two. And then look out, and people start acting goofy. It won't be a good thing. Projection, all this stuff, projecting on other people and thinking, you know, like split mind, people suffering from split mindedness, schizophrenia, etc. They can do crazy stuff because they project so strongly onto others, that what they want to do to others, they think others want to do to them, and then they just think they're protecting themselves, and so they act out of what of self-preservation, where, you know, the other people, you know, may not have any thought of that whatsoever, but they don't see that, because they're so engrossed in trying to get rid of this despondency through mania that it almost brings about this, you know. It brings about terrible dynamics within the mind that are baffling to us. You know, it's really, you know, the struggles with mental health are very vexatious, very much so. And I've been through a lot of stuff, a ton of stuff actually. Trying to help the world actually pulls you down. It can pull you down extremely, because they refuse to acknowledge they have a continuity problem. And to the extent that then you try to help them without that context, then you can really get sucked into all the problem, the mental problems that people have, and then try to look at the problem in your own mind to see what you can do about it. So I've seen all sorts of mental problems, modeling them like clothes, as it were, and seeing just what a vexatious trap they are. Really, you feel hopeless and helpless, and think you got to stimulate yourself out of it, you know, and it ruins your nerves. You get paranoid, you know, you just everything is just, and you feel like there's just no way you can ever get well. There's no way. And ultimately, you can say, "Well, I got no time for any of this stuff because I've got a more important business. I got a continuity problem, and that's you know, I just cannot attend to all these states," and they will go away then. It's your willingness to entertain them that why they're there, actually. When you say, "I only have a continuity problem," it means you're not willing to entertain anything else. You say, you know, sorry schizophrenia, sorry paranoia, sorry manic depression, sorry any psychosis, sorry depression, sorry neurosis, sorry narcissism, you know, sorry self-aggrandizement and all this kind of hero worship, sorry idolatry, sorry jealousy, and you know, the whole Judas mind, you know, and possession, sorry possession. I don't have any time for any of that stuff because I've got a bigger issue. It's the continuity problem. That's the whopper. You know, that's the big fish. And I got no time for you. I cannot entertain any of you anymore. I've got to keep it simple here. This is a serious issue. The rest of the stuff is not really that serious. This is real serious. And again, almost like paradoxically, you find that you're not bothered by that stuff anymore. without taking any pills, you know, if you're on pills and that's a crutch, then you got to do what your doctor tells you to do and be smart about it. You know, don't be doing anything stupid, because if you come off of pills real quickly, you can really get in trouble, because you can go into a super manic episode thinking like, hey, I'm getting better. I want to stimulate myself so much that I never get sick again, you know. And that is when the problem gets really bad. Then you have a crash back into another terrible episode of depression and become suicidal. And I've seen it happen. I mean, there are people I know who have committed suicide. And I was unable to help them at the time. I wasn't wise enough. And, you know, if you're on medication, be careful about coming off that medication. And be very careful. I'm not a doctor. I'm not advising anything in terms of medication at all. What I am saying is, though, is, from a deeper perspective, don't worry about if you're on medication. That is not the ultimate issue. It's not like if you're on medication, you're a bad person or something. Not at all. I've been on various medications and looking at what they do, and they made me worse. I just realized, wow, these things are terrible. But they do help some people, okay? And some medication actually helped me, saved my life. It was just an anti-anxiety medication. And it actually saved my life. I believe it really helped me a lot. And then at some point I realized, okay, it is not a cure. So I've got to go off it gradually. And I gradually got off of it. And it felt terrible anxiety then. But I was able to, I had some hope at that point. I said, no, I'm gonna be able to work this through. And I'm going to be okay. And I don't have to rely on it, you know, forever. So don't think there's something bad about you at all. No, don't look at it that way. Look at it as, say, you know what, I need to keep it simple, I need to keep it easy, I got a continuity problem, everybody has exactly the same problem, and that's what's really important. So I'm going to drop my all the other thoughts and turmoil and everything else, trying to figure out, you know, neurosis, all that stuff. I mean, you can waste your entire life trying to, you know, read all these psychological books and trying to figure out what is neurosis, you know, what is my neurosis. A lot of people have done that, and a lot of, you know, wealthy people went through all this psychotherapy back in the day. I don't know if they still do now. Maybe they just take medications now. Nobody's got time for therapy. But can you read all this stuff by Adler and Jung and Karen Horney and Freud and Alexander Lowen and all the big wigs and Reich and Fritz Perls, and you know, it just there's an endless of Carl Rogers, you know, and it goes on and 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 on. And they've all got their theories of neuroses and the human condition and stuff like that. But there's not a single one of those. Not a single one of those who ever said, folks, your problem is you have a continuity problem. And as a matter of fact, that's the only problem that anyone has on the planet. It's the only problem there will ever be, is a continuity problem. Not a single one has ever said that. So you're just wasting your time with all that stuff, actually. But if you're used to it, be careful in dropping it, you know. you need to be smart, because you have a continuity problem right there, a little one. I'm saying, well, how do I edge myself out of this? You know, so it's not easy to edge yourself out of all this nonsense in the world. It's not easy for me. I'm still edging my way out of it. I read a book by Paul Brunton, by the Secret Path. I just went through it a little bit. I discovered it in somewhere. I said, and that was a key book for a lot of people. And I realized that my parents' generation was really influenced by that book a lot. And I just said, wow, you know, there's a lot of stuff in here that it doesn't identify the continuity problem at all, really. It doesn't. and yet I realized that I've been carrying all this stuff my whole life, like baggage, you know, of like feeling I need to address all this stuff because the older generation felt this stuff super important. So I tried to help the older generation as a young person. And they were all enmeshed in either this, you know, the Secret Path kind of stuff, Paul Brunton and the Masters of the East, and Baird Spaulding, Masters of Life and Teachings, Masters of the East, and you know, all this esoteric, you know, theosophy and stuff. Either that, or they're enmeshed in psychotherapy, the whole psychoanalytical movement, you know, or science of mind, and all these things. The high Protestant, and all the stuff that they're enmeshed in. And so in trying to help them, I ended up, like, taking on all that stuff, saying, okay, how can I work with this stuff? And it got into me, you see, and it's not a good thing. So it's difficult to let all that stuff go. But again, remember, we only have a continuity problem, nothing else. Nothing else. So all those thoughts about ourselves, they're not important. They're not important. So you can let go of just millions and millions and millions of thoughts, and they're just simply not important. So I've done that. I mean, I used to have so many thoughts going through my mind, I couldn't sleep at all. In fact, I'd sit there and I'd watch my thought, all these thoughts, and they'd just be like this incredible pyrotechnical show, just like hundreds of thousands or millions of thoughts, just constantly, like, you know, just lightning, like lightning. It's like I was watching a lightning show, all trying to put all this stuff together, you know. Because I could read like 5 books a day or something. I just could absorb so much thought. I could absorb so much thought, and then all this thought would be playing off relative to all the other thought, and I'd just be sitting there like transfixed by it. I couldn't sleep. This went on for decades, but the fact is, all those thoughts are gone now. I don't have any more of those thoughts. Just, they don't even arise at all. They can, but I can also equally say it's not even important. Keep it simple. I read that book by Paul Brunt, and I just said, keep it simple here. Yeah. Very nice, some good stuff in there. Absolutely. But I said, you know what? I need to keep it even simpler than this stuff. Because I have a continuity problem. This is not addressing the continuity problem. And so I can tell you that it's doable, because I've done it to a large extent. That those of you who are overwhelmed with thought, you absolutely can get free of that bit by bit as you more and more say, I just have a continuity problem. That's all that I have. That's really the key. It's really the key. One of the great keys. There can be other keys, you know, but this is a great key to success. Is everybody has the exact same problem. It's the continuity problem. Meaning we are so used to being so off track with all our opinions of what can happen to pure spaciousness, that we simply are totally flustered at the notion that nothing can happen to it. we say, what do you mean by nothing? You know, you mean nothing like this or nothing like that? Or what kind of nothing are you talking about? We cannot deal with the idea of nothing or impossible. Let me have some pineapple juice here. And so we have this severe continuity problem. We feel we can't deal with nothing. We cannot deal with nothing. What are you talking about? That would be like, oh, what would happen to us? Trader Joe's pineapple juice. Very, very good. So we have this gigantic continuity problem. No matter how you slice it, it's a gigantic continuity problem. We just say, I can't, you know, I'm used to perception, I'm used to opinion, I'm used to belief, I'm used to relativity, I'm used to duality, I'm used to thought, thinking, I'm used to specialness, I'm used to all this stuff, false belief, you know. How can I just be without all that stuff? How is that possible? So, continuity issue. Like an Eskimo or something, just living in the igloo their whole lives, and you say, you know, you need to go to the tropical island or something. That's where your real home is. And they say, I can't do that. I'm used to the freezing cold, you know. So you say, well, you know, let's put on a real warm suit and let's warm it up, and so you feel nice and toasty and warm, and that gives you the feeling of what it's going to be like on the tropical island. Stuff is going to be even better. But so you have to have something that resolves the continuity issue. But again, keep it simple. Keep it simple. Keep it simple. Keep it easy. Keep it simple. Keep it easy. all the stuff on YouTube and the internet, etc. It's all stimulation, complex thought, all this, you know, the party girl thing of stimulation. Let's be sexy. Let's be energetic. Let's be energized. Let's be adrenalized. You know, let's be hyped up. Let's be in a stimulated mood. In general, all that stuff gets into you. It gets into you, and it plays with your mind. Those thoughts actually are playing with your mind. Actually, they're actually playing in your mind with one another. But your mind seems to be like transfixed by it, because look at all the stuff that's happening. Look at all the stuff that's happening. Wow, this is happening over there. There's so much stuff happening. There's nothing happening in spaciousness, nothing happening to spaciousness at all. Nothing happening to spaciousness. Those thoughts are not important. In real terms, because that's our goal. We believe that something can happen to pure spaciousness. In other words, something can happen to God, because we want to be the new God on the block. We want to be the new God. We want to say, you know, we're God. So obviously, in that mind, in that desire, we believe that God is a decoration within the new spaciousness that we are. So decorations, of course, decorations can be altered. So we think that we can alter God, pure spaciousness. And that shows that we are indeed the new God, and that the old God is just a decoration in our greater domain. So that's what we're trying to do. That's what we believe. Of course, it's not happening. And that's the secret of the sages, the secret of Ramana. Well, he's not doing anything. What did he do? What did he stop? What did he cure? Did he cure cancer? I mean, what's going on here? No, he realized that nothing can affect reality, pure spaciousness. God cannot. So there's nothing he needs to do. He doesn't need to stop anything. He doesn't need to prevent anything. He doesn't need to say, hey, he can't do that. You know, that chemical is going, that's going to pollute God. You know, that's going to pollute God. It's going to pollute pure spaciousness. Can you pollute pure spaciousness? Can radioactivity harm pure spaciousness? No, it cannot. So he's not out there stopping stuff. He's not Superman flying into the rescue, holding up the falling building or the train that just, you know, the bridge collapses. Superman's holding up the train. Is not doing that. So we say, well, what's the big deal? What's the big deal about this bloke? You know, what's he doing? What did he do? Did he invent the defibrillator or the heart stents or something? What did he do? When your heart stops, the body's heart stops, does pure spaciousness stop? When your life stops, does pure spaciousness stop? Does it stop? Does it start? Does it stop? Does it go somewhere? Can it hide somewhere? What can happen to isn'tness, you know? Pure isn'tness. What is it that can happen to it, actually? So everything is just a decoration in pure isn'tness. But it's nothing's causative in relation to pure isn'tness, right? Nothing's causative in relationship to God. Nothing is causative. We can be co-creators in the direction of causation, but we cannot be causative to God. God caused us. We didn't cause God. Pure spaciousness, pure isn'tness caused isness, okay? Everything that arises in it. But isness didn't cause pure isn'tness, okay? It's even though there's a reciprocation, there is a causation, there is a direction of causation there. The isness gives witness to the isn'tness. Okay, so it completes the circle of creation, as it were, but the isness doesn't give rise to the isn'tness. Okay, doesn't create the isn'tness. The isn'tness is primary. This is very important. The pure spaciousness is primary. The zero dimensionality is primary. And then all that arises in it gives witness to it. That's why we say we're the Son of God. The Son of God. And Jesus said, God is greater. Yeah, I'm the Son of God. I mean, I'm representing the sonship of God to the planet. But God is greater. God is primary. We are that which shows the greatness of God, the greatness of the pure isn'tness, the pure spaciousness, by the isness of you know, the sonship. The sonship is one seamless, all that arises is the sonship. But that's not primary. So these are the kind of focuses and consideration that knocks out the other stuff. The other stuff's not important anymore. You see this? And believe me, I'm very happy that I'm not still reading those psychology books. I must have read every single one that was ever printed. And it didn't really help. I tell you, it didn't help. But I thought maybe the next book would. You know, so I go to the library and I take home 15 books. I go through every single one of them. And I'd say, I didn't do it, go back to the library, get 15 more books. Or go to a bookstore and buy, you know, all these paperbacks, and you get paperbacks for cheap, $1.95 or $2.95 or whatever. You know, and I just go through. I must have, you know, donated so many books, thousands upon thousands upon thousands of books I've donated, you know, to the library. I mean, just so many books. Didn't help. So sir, I'm sure glad I'm not doing that anymore, that is for sure. I mean, you can go along and say, this doesn't work, and you can go on forever that way. Go through every book on the face of the earth and say, this isn't it. How long is that going to take? We don't have time to do that, do we? So you have to be smart. You have to say, wait a minute, I got to keep it simple and easy. I don't have time for all this stuff. I got a severe problem. I need to know what actually helps. And it seems difficult, doesn't it? Because you say, well, I kind of understand, but I can't grasp it. You know, it's just like, what is it? But it's gradually accepting that nothing needs to help, actually. You don't need to be helped. You're not in that predicament, actually. You do have a continuity problem, but that problem was solved by God. And we simply can perceive zero dimensionality. Perceive it instead of know it. It's perceptible. It's kind of, you might call it a perception of isn'tness. But of course, how can we perceive isn'tness, right? You cannot really perceive it. So it's almost like an invisibility, and yet at some level, we're perceiving it. We're experiencing perception at some level, way deeper than our eyes, our senses cannot, don't have the subtlety to register this symbol of isn'tness, okay? It doesn't have the subtlety, but there, we do have the capacity within perception. God put it there for us, where there's a subtle, super subtle perception that reminds us of isn'tness. It's not, you cannot perceive isn'tness, of course not, but it gives us the flavor. So there's this sort of a very similar flavor, as it were. If we ever had this flavor of like isn'tness, we say, oh, I kind of remember isn'tness now, you know. But it's not the coarse perception that we get from, it doesn't matter how beautiful the sunset is, it's still incredibly coarse. And that will never remind us of isn'tness. It will not remind us. We have, our senses have deeper senses, as it were, subtler spiritual senses that can register this great subtlety, that can perceive that's very, very subtle. And that reminds us of reality. And that's what the great sages have told us, that there is this very subtle recognition, very subtle recognition, that is still an opinion. It is still opinion about reality. It is still a perception. It's not a knowing, but it's so subtle and smooth that it reminds us. It reminds us of isn'tness, pure isn'tness. And therefore we can give up our notion that somehow pure isn'tness is merely residing as a decoration within our opinions of it. So you hear this stuff and you say, yeah, but that's not like that psychology book I read. You're that guy on the public education channel who's got a book out, and they're talking about all our troubles and stuff, and on television, the therapy show on television where the doctor's saying, you need to get over your addiction. Yeah, this is so different. How do I put it together, you know? Yeah, you don't put it together. It's like on the golf course. Let's say you're trying to imitate Jack Nicklaus. I grew up trying to imitate Jack Nicklaus because he was the greatest golfer of all time. You think he must know everything. But the fact is, I couldn't do it like Jack Nicklaus. Because only Jack Nicklaus could do it like Jack Nicklaus, because he had his build, his will, his mind, everything about him was unique to Jack Nicklaus. So I went through so many years of misery at golf trying to swing like Jack Nicklaus. And finally I said, you know what, I gotta find my own swing. Then I, you know, look at Fred Couples and Greg Norman and various Savvy Ballesteros and all these different golfers and stuff. And, you know, I just tried hundreds and hundreds of things, swings. Now, so each one of us has to find our own way, so to speak, that is right for us. So now when I try a different swing, I say, yeah, but how do I make that kind of like Jack Nicklaus' swing, you know? I said, I can't do it like Jack, but I want to be close to like Jack. So I'm going to change this and change that, but I still want this part and that part and that part. It's like that. It's we say, okay, I hear what you're saying, but I need to make it more like, you know, the guy on television is telling me. Because that the guy he's famous, you know, he's famous. Of course, the best golf teachers tell you, you got to find your own swing. You know, don't swing like someone else. Swing like you. Find your swing. Because that's your go-to swing. And that's how you're going to be able to play. You won't be able to play like Jack Nicklaus, okay? You got to play like you. And you have to have your go-to swing. You have and what works for you. You then make it work, and ride that horse. And when you get into a situation like it's so difficult, you say, "No, not a problem for me. I know my swing. I've got my swing. I'm going to use my swing. So it's not a problem. I'll be fine." So, all those books. Ultimately, you have to keep it easy. Keep it simple. There's no way around it. There's no way around it. So the books ultimately don't matter, because it's your own insistence to keep it simple, keep it easy, because I have a tremendously deep-rooted, intense, deep-rooted problem, and I cannot be chasing all over the place with this situation. And I know that it has to be resolved. Absolutely must resolve, and so I have to focus on what really resolves it, and that is actually very, very simple, because it's all inclusive, right? It's a non-exclusive mindset, a perception of non-exclusivity, of sameness, 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 no specialness, all inclusive, everything is equally blessed. Only that is going to resolve the situ continuity problem. We have to be reminded of reality. Only that will work. Nothing else will work. So again, keep it simple, keep it easy. It's a perception. It's healed perception. It's not what thoughts do I have in my mind. That thoughts don't do it. Thoughts in our mind don't do it. So we don't need to be thinking about what thoughts do I have, or, you know, did I have, what thought did I have yesterday? Now here's something else that might be helpful for you. I'll introduce another angle to the situation, which I haven't talked about in any previous video. The ego, or our fear of a continuity issue, where we say, well, I got to avoid going back to, you know, realizing that I never left reality. So the ego turns that upside down and backwards and says, you have a continuity problem in that you're not able to separate from reality effectively yet. So you're afraid of really fully separating. So that's a continuity problem for you. And so we need to kind of gradually separate. Okay, gradually separate. That's how the ego looks at the continuity problem. And so what we're doing is, in terms of our gradual separation, is perception. Perception was made to solve the ego's continuity problem. And memory was made to solve the ego's continuity problem. How do we separate from reality? The ego says, you keep trying to remember reality. You want to go back. You need to, you know, get free of pure spaciousness, the zero dimensionality of isn'tness. You need to get free of it. So how do we do that? Well, we make a memory of it. So we are totally caught up in this desire, this memory thing about, I need to remember. You know, oh yeah, I try to remember how I was back earlier in my life. I try to remember yesterday. Memory, memory, memory. Memory is just a device that we're using to solve the anti-continuity problem, as it were, of how we can separate from reality. Perception is the exact same thing. It's the exact same, the perception. Perception and memory are two sides of one coin. So actually, our whole psyche of perception and memory and all this stuff is actually the ego's way of trying to solve the continuity problem of how to separate from reality, thinking that we're so used to reality, it's a big problem for us to step into this new reality where we're God. So that is a very unique and accurate way of looking at our whole entire persona, psyche, thoughts, memory, perception, all of that. God had nothing to do with creating any of that. We have devised that as a device, these devices to help deal with the continuity problem, the anti-continuity problem, how to separate from reality. And yet, we're so used to that now. Opinions, belief, memory, perception, that, you know, we're afraid of dropping them, this device. So what we need to do is, again, we have these super subtle perceptions, capability of perception that is able to remind us of reality. It's still an opinion, it's still a perception. But we don't need to remember it. It's a seamless, what arises in us is seamless. What the ego does, as soon as something like that arises, the ego says, great, now you need to remember it. So then you split from it. You have like a split mind. And you say, okay, I'm no longer experiencing that. I'm now working on remembering that. So this happened to everybody so many times, you know, in your life, where you get a glimpse of, you think, oh, I glimpsed it. And immediately you turn into a memory, a process of remembering it. I had a perception and I'm remembering, what was that perception like? You know, okay, I'm trying to remember it. That's actually a tactic to deal with the anti-continuity problem of how to separate from reality. Very strong tendency in all of us to do that. Turn it into a remember perception. Oh yeah. Yeah, I remember I had that perception. Yeah, but what was that perception like? Let me write it down. Let me take some notes. Oh, I had this experience. Okay, let me start to take some notes on it, you know. I know a lot of people, they go to these retreats and these teachers and satsangs and everything. They're furiously taking notes and filling a whole notebook. Okay, they said that. I need to go home. I need to remember what they said. I need to remember that. Yeah, I need to remember it. Whereas like here in this video, you see, this is a real condition. It's like playing around a golf. On a real tough golf course, you know, you're immersed in it. You can't quit either. You got to play 18 holes, and you're not supposed to quit. No, hardly anybody quits. I don't know if I've ever seen anybody quit. Very rare. And you realize you're in for it, and you say, I've got to buckle down here. because this stuff is coming at me fast and furious. And I can't take notes. I don't have time to take notes. Here's the next shot. I mean, here's the ball. And then, you know, I got to hit it on the green somehow. I got to get it in the hole somehow. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I'm going to have to try. I mean, it's like really tough. As you realize, I don't know if I can hit this shot. So what happens if the ball falls into that? You know, I'm going to lose. My ball's going to go in the lake. You know, it's just like, oh, God, it's just, how am I going to do this? It's just like so intense. You just got to say, I just got to try my very best and just hope for a good result. And you hit the ball. And sometimes, you know, you say, well, that wasn't too terrible. Maybe I can, you know, and eventually you finally get the ball in the hole and you say, oh, my gosh, how'd I do that? I don't know, but I did it. It's like that, exactly like that. Don't worry about remembering something. That's the trick. That's how the ego tricks us. Just let everything, just absorb it, and don't worry about remembering it. Just keep absorbing it. Just keep saying, yeah, okay, I'm hearing this, I'm hearing this right now, I'm hearing this right now, I'm hearing this right now, I'm hearing this right now. Just keep practicing, staying in the now. I'm experiencing this right now. Don't worry about remembering anything. It's a trick. Memory is the worst trick of all. Because just as we are right now, we're already in pure spaciousness. So what is there to remember? What exactly do we need to remember? When I was in pure spaciousness? Oh, I remember back when I was in pure spaciousness. What do you mean? We're in it right now. We're in it right now. What do we need to remember for? But the one memory that we need is the subtle memory. But it's not really a memory in the way that we look at memory at all. Because it's seamless. It doesn't disappear on us. It's the memory we don't need to remember. That kind of thing. It's the memory we don't need to remember. It stays with us. It's the same. It's the same. Everything's blessed. So you don't cut it off and say, okay, everything is blessed. Okay, wait a minute. I need to stop that now. Now I need to work on remembering that. Remembering it. No. That is the memory. It's the memory of reality. But see, we're using memory to try to forget reality. So really the whole thing about our memory is actually a way of trying to forget. Same with perception. But what we do is we give memory and perception a different use, and we use it as a way to actually remember. But right now, we're using it to forget. That's why our lives are so bizarre. You know, people, I've seen them go through their lives, they get old, they die, and they say, it's just like, wow, I mean, I just really nothing to it. I mean, it's just, what happened? What happened? What is this? What are all these ridiculous things, the situations we call our life and stuff? It's literally a dynamic practicing of forgetting. Forgetting. We're trying to forget reality. And so when this new memory comes, we say, whoa, that's not helping me forget reality. And we say, oh, good, okay. So we don't need to fragment it, you see. We don't need to fragment it out. Chop it all up and have concatenations where we have a whole chain of memory. Just one memory, not a chain of memory. Just one memory. So it is a little different. It's a little different. Like, hey, this is a different way to use the mind. You know, it's a different way. It's interesting. Wow. It's not that late. Getting a little cold out here. I'm going to get a heater out here one of these days. You know that? I think I'm going to get a heater out here. One of those propane heaters that can heat the space up, because it's still winter. What is it, January? It's on, you know, you're watching this January 1st, you know, it's still the dead of winter. Yeah, I know California, LA was like, what, 86, and people were in bathing suits at the beach, and by the way, the water's very warm. I talked to some very keen fishermen, and I may talk to some more, who are out in the Pacific Ocean, they're saying they're spotting fish they've never even seen before in these waters. The sardines are in Monterey Bay. They shouldn't be there. The whales are coming and feeding off of them. The tuna is in nearby shore. The water is warm. We have an El Nino situation like this, and how it's going to play out is not certain, but it's very possible that we could have just a tremendous amount of rain in California coming up in maybe late January or February, March, something like that. It could, and when it comes, it could just be inundated. And El Nino year, that when the waters get really warm, the fish, warm water fish, you see them off the coast. You see them in here where normally you don't see those fish at all. So there's a lot of indications that, and again, you know, this is like summer conditions in December 30th, you know, summer conditions, really. That doesn't last, you know, things flip-flop, they flip-flop. So my feeling is a lot of rain, maybe too much rain, flooding in California is very possible. So the whole world is getting very aggressive, right? The whole mood of aggression in the world. Aggression has led to this quote-unquote global, I call it global instability of weather. Not necessarily global warming, global instability. There is some heat sinks, there is some heat being stored in the ocean at great depths. The ocean absorbs it, but it's there as energy. And so, you know, and then of course, it can cause extremes of all sorts of types of situations. You can have a lot of ice, a lot of cold, a lot more intense storms, etc. It's global aggression, aggressive weather. The weather is aggressive. The people of the planet are aggressive. The moods are aggressive. People don't realize how aggressive we've all become. Myself included, we've all become more aggressive, really, compared to the past. You know, oh my gosh, people could be so much more mellow in the past. Really, really, just the levels of aggression have just multiplied exponentially, and now we live in this world with super aggressive weather. Super aggressive weather, and we could be experiencing 2014. Could be a year. It's going to be a year, I would say, of super aggression. Super aggression, and that very aggression could, you know, fall on its head. Humpty Dumpty. You got this super aggressive, you know, quantitative easing thing. The whole thing that the Fed has done is super aggressive. And they say progressive and aggressive are like two sides of the same coin, actually. You know, the whole free speech movement, it was really a very aggressive movement about trying to control what people said, actually. It wasn't really about free speech. It was very aggressive, saying, this is how we want you to speak, actually. We don't like the way you're speaking. We want you to speak this way. We want you to say these things. We want you to believe this. It's very aggressive politically. It's incredibly, I don't know, I can't remember a time in the world where there was more aggression in the political spectrum worldwide. Is people are simply feeling that they need to control what you think, what you say, you know, and just the whole thing. That is like, and they're super aggressive about it, super aggressive. Way more than before, using social media, etc. They can amplify that aggression. So my experience is the world is becoming, you know, ultra fanatically aggressive. Through and through and through, through and through. Just the TV shows, everything's showing aggression, isn't it? Just notice it. The national religion is football, you know? And just this incredible, uber-aggressive sport is just dragging people off. The fights, all the fighting that's going on, extreme stuff, you know? And super aggression, super aggressive. And it's getting into everybody. And again, not judging, I used to watch professional wrestling at a time, you know, it's like super aggression, isn't it? And people jumping on each other and stomping and just doing these incredibly aggressive things. It was fake, of course. The outcomes and the punch, 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 punch like that. And they weren't really hitting, it's fake, but it looks real. To some people, you think, wow, it is super incredible aggression in professional wrestling, okay? And people just love that, love it. So I used to watch that, and I said, you know what, this is ridiculous, you know? It's not good. I used to watch boxing and stuff like that. And eventually you say, hey, wait a minute, I got a severe problem, I got a continuity problem, I don't have time for this. You know, I just don't have time for it. I still watch, occasionally I'll watch a football game, 49er football game, a little bit, or like, you know, I didn't watch the Super Bowl in 2012, didn't watch any of it. I said, I got more important stuff to deal with. So, there's no judgments. I'm just saying that you gotta keep it simple, and you got a more important problem to deal with, for sure. And that is the continuity problem. And you'd better find out what the answer to that is, which means you gotta keep it simple. You can't be searching everywhere. You got to search where the answer is. And so the stuff that pulls you elsewhere, you say, whoa, gotta keep it simple here. Forget it. That's why I'm not at that party. I said, forget it. I gotta keep it simple, folks. You know, I paid my respects, but hey, gotta keep it simple. I know at the party nobody's going to keep it simple, right? Yeah, nobody's going to keep it simple. You know, blah, 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 blah. There's no simplicity there. There's just thoughts just all over the place. I mean, where are you ever in a place where thoughts are, everything's simple, easy, simple, no extraneous thought? Where are we ever in a situation like that? Publicly, I mean, where can you find that? I don't know. Where it's just natural, entering a Buddhist, you know, university training, you know, for 8 years or something, I don't know. Where do you just go so you can just abide in this simple focus? Where do you go? I don't know. Never found a place. So I'm just doing it here. My finger is numb. Why is that? All the fingers are numb. Maybe it's getting colder here. So the new year, the new year's resolution should be let's keep it simple. I'm going to keep it simple this year. Real simple. It's necessary because the world is going to become super aggressive, super complicated, too many thoughts. You know, we live in what's called the information age, right? Well, you know what? It's possible to have too much information. Why? Well, imagine if you lived in an ice cream shop or something. And you said, oh, I love ice cream. I got all the ice cream. It's amazing. I'm just going to eat ice cream constantly. You know? Well, you know, eventually you're going to get real fat and it's not good for you. So it's possible to have too much of a good thing, too much ice cream, right? Too much information. We have way too much information. The information age is not necessarily a great age. At all, because what it does is there's so much extraneous thought and distraction and stimulation, it's a disaster for you. Because what we really need to do is narrow the focus down to keep it simple, keep it easy, and just focus on the resolution of the continuity issue. There's nothing else we need to do. So all that other stuff is just unnecessary distraction, junk food that makes us sick. So the so-called great hallowed, you know, information age, the digital age, that computers are so incredible. No, they're not. This age is not some incredible age. Not in the slightest bit. Really. It's actually just a massive distraction. It's not a great age. It's a not great age at all. Very, very impoverished age. The age of the information age is a very lousy age to be in. Terrible. You don't need much information, you just need the answer to the continuity problem. That's it. That is it. How much information does Ramana Maharshi need? I mean, you think he needs computers and tablets and smartphones? I need all this information. No. Doesn't need any information. He knows that what we're trying to do doesn't work. So there's nothing special or important about it whatsoever. There's no information. Is there any information available on how to change reality? And the answer is there is none. There's absolutely none. So what do we need information age for? We don't really need an information age. That's a fact. Don't really need an information age. Not at all. I find it the most terrible age, you know, abstraction. The pressure is so extreme, and it's so difficult to block it all out. And to say, I don't need any of this stuff. I don't need all this stuff. It's totally extraneous. You go into a store, any store, and there's just like almost like unlimited amounts of all those distractions, right? Oh, God, it's just endless, right? No matter what store you go into, it never ends. And you'd say, I don't want any of that stuff at all. I don't need any of it at all. Totally irrelevant. So we have information, we live in the age of irrelevance, insisting that irrelevance is relevant. That is really the age we live in, the age of irrelevancy. It's irrelevant. And yet we are being told it's relevant. So we have all the stuff that we're trying to say it's relevant, it's relevant, it's relevant, it's relevant, and it's not. And so of course it's driving us nuts. I mean, so many people are on medications, it's unbelievable. If all the medications in the world were stopped today, people would go, you know, they'd completely freak out. The planet would completely freak out. It wouldn't freak me out in the slightest bit. But people are so totally trying to make irrelevancy relevant, you know, that it just, they need to medicate themselves, be medicated. In ancient times, there were a lot of us that were enlightened. A lot of us were freed of delusion. There were a lot in ancient times. Very few now. Very few. This is the Dark Ages, or the Kali Yuga. It's like right now where we're at is like the lowest of the low. You know, it's just so low. The age of irrelevancy, where people can tell you every single trivial thing, you know, just an infinite amount of trivia. None of it means anything. Look at all these game shows, all these trivia, and the returning champion who is able to, the Rock, blah, 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 the Rock of Gibraltar or something. Oh, yeah, everybody, yeah. They're all cheering on all this nonsense. We have just incredible computers. What computers do is they multiply irrelevancy. That's what gadgets do, that's what computers do. They multiply irrelevancy and try to give the impression that irrelevancy is relevant. It's not. Do you think Ramana needed a smartphone? Is he some deprived little poor guy? Dude, if he only lived now, he'd have a smartphone. You know, he could be irrelevant. Yeah, poor Ramana, he's just not relevant. You know, doesn't have a tablet. He could have music. He could have earbuds, man. Wow, how cool. You know, poor guy. If he just lived now, like, he'd be cool like me. He'd be wearing earbuds and, you know, really tuned into the relevancy of all this stuff. Wow, you know. Well, what we're tuned into is irrelevancy, thinking that makes us relevant. But that, again, is a anti-continuity issue thing, technique of trying to separate from reality, of being enmeshed in irrelevancy. It's thinking, this is showing my power because I'm totally distracted by irrelevancy. I've forgotten reality. What spaciousness, what's that? You know, what? Pure spaciousness, never heard of it. Yeah, never heard of it. Pop another pill. Go to another rave, whatever, you know. Absolutely. Age of irrelevance. And of course, in the age of irrelevance, the truly relevant is seen as it is irrelevant. See, everything's backwards. We think that the irrelevant is relevant, and we view the relevant as irrelevant. And so that's why, like, someone, Ramana Maharshi, falls through the cracks a lot. Now, more and more falling through the cracks. People say, who is that guy in diapers or something, you know? What is that? Crazy, what is that, you know? Nonsense. Yes, it's irrelevant. Look at that irrelevancy there. So it's getting more and more difficult to hang on to what is relevant, because how do you filter out all the